That song wasn't bad, huh? I mean, oh my gosh. Hey, listen, from time to time, you just got to do it. You know what I'm saying? If it's in the closet, you got to bust it out. For those of you that were not here back in June, I wore this in June. Some guys got together and bought me this suit for my birthday. So technically, this is my birthday suit. So tomorrow, when people ask you what happened to NewSpring this weekend, you can just say, our pastor preached in his birthday suit. And it'll be online, and so you can watch it all. Anyway, that'd be great. Hey, I want to welcome Columbia with us. If you're at the Columbia campus or if you're online, I want to welcome you here and, of course, our Anderson people. If you have a Bible with you, I want you to go ahead and go to Daniel chapter 2. We're in a series called Overwhelmed. We are going to spend the next several weeks in Daniel. Last week, we're in Daniel 1. And this week we're in Daniel 2. And for the next 2 weeks, we'll actually be in Daniel 3, just in case you want to read ahead. While you're turning there, I'll kind of set it up like this. NewSpring Church is the only church I've ever served as the pastor of. I've never been a senior pastor before. And so for those of you, especially that have been around for a while, I appreciate you allowing me to learn on the job. Because if it seems like there are some days where I don't know what I'm doing, it's because there are some days that I don't know what I'm doing. I really, on most days, feel really over my head. But I've got an amazing team of people around me, both staff and volunteers, that make this thing tick. And that whole presence of God thing is the major factor there. And so God is really blessed. But before I was a pastor at NewSpring, I served two other churches. I was ordained, licensed in a smaller Baptist church. And I served at a church that had about 100 people in it as the youth pastor. And then I served at a church that had about 180, 200 people in it as the youth pastor. Now, if you're not familiar with small church cultures, if you're the youth pastor in a small church, you're not really just the youth pastor. You're the minister of miscellaneous. You do a host of other activities. And one of my jobs was on Sunday mornings in the last church I served, I was announcement boy. I called myself the minister of announcements. I literally rolled out about 5 minutes before the service started, and I would do the announcements every week, which made me, in a smaller church, it made me the most popular person in the church 10 minutes before the service started, because people are trapping me going, hey, you need to announce the Quilting for Jesus meeting Tuesday night. And I'm like, I'm not sure Jesus ever quilted, but I'll write that down. He was a carpenter. You understand? Okay, I'm not even going to. And then I had to get up and pretend I was excited about it. Like, and Tuesday night at 7 o'clock, the Quilting for Jesus meeting. And I'm thinking, I'm not coming to this thing. But I had to pretend. And then there was the occasions that I would forget to make an announcement, and then I would start to pray, and I would remember the announcement in prayer. And it would be like, and God, bless the men's breakfast Saturday morning at 6 o'clock. And bless every man and lead them to go see Deacon Joe and sign up as soon as possible. We know you're excited about that, God. So I literally had those things happen. Well, one particular Sunday, I was up doing my announcement deal. And right before I'd gone on stage, somebody had told me about a lady in our church that was getting ready to have a baby. Now, here at NewSpring Church, we have people have babies all the time. I mean, like, we got babies flying everywhere. It's like, oh my gosh, you guys, we did a relationship series, and y'all took the Song of Solomon seriously. And so I don't know. Anyway, so babies everywhere. But in a smaller church, this is like the only, it was like there was one pregnant lady. She was the one pregnant lady, and she was having a baby. And I was told right before I walked on stage to do the announcements, I swear, this is what somebody told me. They said, hey, they called her by her name. They said, so-and-so's water broke, and she's on her way to the hospital right now to give birth. Well, I just figured that was information that our church would want to know, because we've been praying for this lady for a long time or whatever. So I'm on stage, and I was like, oh, yeah, by the way, found out right before I walked on stage that so I called her by her name. I said, her water broke, and she's on her way to have the baby. And everybody's like, ah. And I thought I'd done a good job. After the service, there was a little senior adult lady in the church that found me about once a month and told me what I'd done wrong. Now, I'm not picking on senior adults. I love senior adults, but this particular one did not like me, and she didn't mind telling me what I did wrong. She was a shorter lady, so I had a hard time seeing her sometimes. And so I'm not even, like, she came up and she'd pull on my thing. I'd be like, oh, there you are. So anyway, we started a dialogue that day, and I never will forget, she was mad. She was visibly angry. She was shaking, and she said, we don't talk about that. And I did not know, I swear, I did not know what she was talking about. I thought maybe, I was like, yeah, I thought quilting for Jesus was a bad idea too. But I didn't say that because she's probably in that club or whatever. And I said, I'm sorry, I've obviously offended you. What is it that we don't talk about? And she said, you said that girl's water broke. Okay, I'm just going to call a timeout right here and tell you, I had no clue what that meant. Like, I just didn't know. Most single dudes here, you don't know either. And I just don't Google it, all right? Just, ask your mom, okay? Because I honestly swear, I did not know what that meant. And I was like, was that a bad thing? She said, yes, it's bad. And I was like, oh, dang. So literally, I went to the hospital later on, and I told the girl, I was like, I told everybody, your water broke. I feel so bad. She went, that's not a big deal. So then I was confused. I couldn't even find a Bible verse about that. And I was really messed up until I began to understand that church culture for years, that was the attitude. If something was messy, church wasn't supposed to talk about it. In fact, let's be honest, and I don't know where you're watching from online or if you're listening to podcasts or whatever, but I just want to be real honest about the southeastern part of the United States. I don't know about other areas of the country. I travel there. I don't live there. But I can tell you the truth. After doing church culture for 20 years in the southeastern part of the United States, most people go to church just to make an appearance. That's it. We show up every Sunday just to make an appearance. And the goal is not to celebrate Jesus, although that's what they did in the early church. The whole thing revolves around the fact that a guy was dead and came back to life. So there's supposed to be celebration involved. There's supposed to be community involved. Like we're supposed to actually enjoy being around each other. There's supposed to be some grace involved because you know what? Every person sitting in this room here tonight probably screwed up something this week. And we show up, hey, listen, I don't know about you, but I need some grace this week because I've messed up. Hey, from time to time, you know what? We're supposed to show up to church and we're supposed to get a good swift kick in the pants. We all need that from time to time. But that's not what it's about. In a lot of church cultures, it's simply about making an appearance and looking good. Hey, let's get even more real and let's get even more honest. If you dress like this in most churches in the southeastern part of the United States and you're a dude, you can have sex with any woman you want to during the week that's not your wife as long as you put on a suit on Sunday. Listen, it has nothing to do with who you are. It has everything to do with how you appear. Ladies, you can gossip. You can enter into an affair through Facebook. But you show up on Sunday and you let your hair look good and your makeup look good and you put on a pair of pantyhose and people think you love Jesus. Let me just ask a question. How has that served the church for the past 20 years? How's that working? Because we show up, and here's the pressure we feel. We got to be perfect. Perfect people go to church. People who have it all together go to church. So we make an appearance. And here's what we've learned in church culture. If everything in your life is not awesome, pretend it's awesome. Fake it. And so there are people that show up to churches, even NewSpring Church. And our goal is not to hear from Jesus. Our goal is to fake it till we make it. Our goal is to fake it through and pretend, hey, everything in my life is awesome. I have it all together. And then if you can't fake it anymore because you get found out in the church, one of two things happen. Number one, you're asked never to come back to that church again because you're not perfect, and our church is for perfect people. Or because you get found out, you go to another church and tell everybody at that church how the former church hurt you. And it just gets, and we show up to church, and we don't want anybody to talk about real issues. We want obscure history lessons and Greek and Hebrew. But don't talk to me about anything that's going on in my life. For example, if I want to upset the apple cart, I can pick one of two subjects and tick a lot of people off. I can talk about sex or I can talk about money. And people lose their dang mind. You shouldn't talk about that in church. You shouldn't talk about that in church. You shouldn't talk about that in church. When, listen, I've been in ministry now for over 20 years. 90% of the people that ask, can I talk to you about something? You know what it has to do with? Sex or money. I've started asking people, can I come by and talk to you sometime? Sex or money? Excuse me? Sex or money? Which one are we going to talk? What, which one are we going to talk about? So it's like, I want you to talk to me about it face to face. I just don't want you to preach about it in the church. Because, see, here's what we believe. Here's what we believe. Work with me here. Pretend that this is the cross. Let's pretend that this is the cross. And on this side of the cross, you're saved. And on this side of the cross, you're lost. Now, here's what I know about you if you're on this side of the cross. If you don't know Jesus, you're lost and you're hopeless. There is no hope in your life. And you say, I have issues, I have struggles, I have things I'm dealing with. Let me tell you, on this side of the cross, it's not about what you have, it's about what you don't have. You don't have Jesus. And as long as you don't have Jesus, you will have issues, and you will have things you struggle with, and you will not, listen, eternity is going to suck this side of the cross. Your biggest need in life is a relationship with Jesus Christ. And I know that because I spent 18 years of my life on this side of the cross. I'm not judging you. I know how you feel because I never have forgotten what it was like to be here. But then we meet Christ and we cross over to this side of the cross and we're saved. And the misconception in church world is this. Once you're on this side of the cross, life is easy. Christians have perfect lives. We ride unicorns and eat Lucky Charms and sing happy songs all day long. Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-ay. But can we just be really, really honest and truthful, and this is going to upset a lot of people? I know people on this side of the cross that are more messed up than the people on that side of the cross. It's just true. Because see, when we come to this side of the cross, we are saved from the penalty of sin, but we bring the presence of sin with us. And all the stuff we did on that side of the cross, guess what? We hook up the U-Haul and it comes too. And life on this side of the cross really can be messy. And the goal on this side of the cross is not to be perfect. The goal of on this side of the cross is to fall in love with Jesus every single day. Are we tracking? So on this side of the cross, people struggle with issues. And one of the issues that people struggle with is depression. Now, I'm just saying, I don't think I've ever heard a message on the subject of depression. Because it's messy. We don't want to deal with that. In spite of the fact that in the past 20 years, depression medication sales have increased 400% in North America. We're the richest and most depressed country in the world. And I've had people tell me, listen, I've heard preachers say this. Well, Christians don't get depressed. Okay. Well, then for 3 years, I'm pretty sure I was probably going to hell. Like, literally, I would hear people, well, Christians don't get depressed. And I would wake up, and I was depressed. And I'd be like, am I saved? To the person here, or the person watching online, that says that Christians do not get depressed, I would simply encourage you to read your Bible. All of it. Not just the fun sections. All of it. Let me talk about four Bible heroes that we all have. If you have any sort of biblical reference, you've at least heard of these four characters in the Bible. First being Moses. Pretty godly man, right? Led a major relocation project. Unbelievable. And then one day he went up a mountain to have his quiet time and God killed him. I don't know if you've read that story. It's really interesting. Elijah, we've actually talked about Elijah here. He's the guy that called fire down from heaven. Pretty incredible miracle. Pretty godly guy. Jonah, Like, you don't even have to be a church person. You've heard about Jonah. And then Paul, the Apostle Paul. How many people here tonight have heard of at least one of those Bible characters? Okay, good, good. Let me read you what they said about themselves, listen to me, in the scriptures. Four of the godliest men that we know in the Bible struggled with depression. Now, not Moses. Hold on, let's talk about Moses. Moses is praying one day, him and God are arguing. And in Numbers chapter 11, verse 14 and 15, this is what Moses said to God. I cannot carry all these people by myself. The burden is too heavy for me. If this is how you are going to treat me, put me to death right now. You ever heard that verse? That was Moses, the man of God. Elijah? Elijah went on top of Mount Carmel and he called down fire from heaven. And a queen named Jezebel got mad, and so she came after him, and he ran. Which, if you had a woman named Jezebel after you, you'd probably run too. That kind of freaked me out. But the Bible says this in 1 Kings chapter 9, verse 3 and 4. Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servant there. So he isolated himself. Don't miss that. While he himself went a day's journey into the desert, he came to a broom tree, sat down under it, and prayed that he might die. I have had enough, Lord, he said. Take my life. You ever been there? I've had enough, Lord. One of the godliest men in the scripture. Hey, if anybody's on this side of the cross, can we agree at least Moses and Elijah were over here? Let's keep going. Jonah? Jonah didn't even play around. This is what Jonah said in Jonah chapter 4, verse 3. Now, O Lord, take my life, for it is better for me to die than to live. And then the Apostle Paul wrote this in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 8. We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about the hardships we suffered in the province of Asia. We were under great pressure, far beyond our ability to endure. Time out. So much for God will never put more on you than you can handle. So much for that little phrase. Paul just blew it up in the scriptures. And then he says this, so that we despaired even of life. Four of the godliest people that we know in the scriptures dealt with depression. So let's talk about that. Let's talk about what it looks like to get so overwhelmed that you don't even want to live. We're going to talk about fear and anxiety specifically in 2 weeks. Tonight, I want to deal very specifically with the subject of depression. I want to set it up with Daniel chapter 2. Now, we looked at Daniel chapter 1 last week. We came up with, out of the scriptures, that God is great and God is able. That God brought Daniel through incredible circumstances. Well, in Daniel chapter 2, we learn a little bit more about this character that we were introduced to in Daniel chapter 1 named Nebuchadnezzar. Now, we're going to talk very specifically about him in 3 or 4 weeks. But Nebuchadnezzar was very unstable in his leadership. Now, I'm not cracking on him because he was the king. And back in those days, if they didn't like the king, they didn't vote you out. They just killed you. That's how it's like, hey, let's kill the king. They had a committee meeting and, hey, we decided to kill you. And he was just dead. So he was a little insecure and he was always kind of curious about who he could and who he could not trust. And so keep that in mind. Also, back in that culture, if a king had a dream, it meant something. They literally thought every dream was the gods, or in Nebuchadnezzar's case that we're about to read, God was specifically talking to him. Now, our dreams today probably don't mean anything, all right? I believe God can and still does speak through dreams, but if you dreamed a giant burrito was chasing you last night, probably means you need to stop eating Moe's right before you go to bed. Has nothing to do. Anyway, so we're tracking there. So they believed that dreams were communication from the gods. Well, Nebuchadnezzar in Daniel chapter 2 had a dream that freaked him out. All of us have probably had a dream that freaked us out before. So he woke up, and he had around him astrologers and wise men, kind of an entourage that he rolled with, and he called them all in. And this was very common to them, because what the king would typically do is he would have a dream, he would call the astrologers in, he would tell them the dream, and then somebody would step up and go, okay, king, let me tell you what that dream means, and he would interpret the dream. But Nebuchadnezzar was having some trust issues. I don't know what happened on this particular day. So Nebuchadnezzar called all of his astrologers in, he called all his entourage in, and he said, all right, guys, here's the deal. I had a dream. I'm freaked out by it. So here's what we're going to do. You're going to tell me what I dreamed, and what it means, and if you don't, I'm killing all you fools. I'm paraphrasing. Well, they kind of looked at each other and was like, okay, that's funny, man. Ha, 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 funny, funny. Seriously, Nebuchadnezzar, tell us the dream, and we will interpret it. And he went, I ain't playing. You're going to tell me the dream, tell me what I dreamed, and tell me the interpretation, or I'm killing all the wise men in the kingdom. Little extreme, but we'll talk about that in a few weeks. But anyway, look at what happened in Daniel chapter 2, verse 10. The astrologers answered the king, there is not a man on earth who can do what the king asks. No king, however great and mighty, has ever asked such a thing of any magician or enchanter or astrologer. What the king asks is too difficult. No one can reveal it to the king except the gods, and they do not live among men. Hadn't heard of Jesus yet. He came along later. It's really cool. He blew that verse up. Verse 12. This made the king so angry and furious that he ordered the execution of all the wise men in Babylon. So the decree was issued to put the wise men to death, and men were sent to look for Daniel and his friends to put them to death. Now, if you're Daniel, is this a little frustrating? Like, you just came out of chapter 1. You just did the whole, I'm not eating that, and I'm not drinking that, and God brought you out, and all of a sudden, you're not even in the king's court. You don't even get a shot at this, and some fool smarted off the king, and Nebuchadnezzar said, that's it, I'm killing everybody. So somebody knocks on Daniel's door and goes, hey, man, I'm here to kill you. And Daniel's probably like, for the love, you got to be kidding me. Seriously? Seriously? Daniel was in the middle of what I think we could all agree is a very overwhelming circumstance. All of us have been there. Some of us are there. Some of us are headed there. Let me tell you how I got there. And then we'll come back and see what Daniel did. I was born in 1971 in Los Angeles, California, into a non-Christian home. My father and my mother did not know Christ, and it was not the most stable situation to be born into. It was just bad, and I don't blame my parents because, listen, before somebody meets Christ, let me just say it this. The potential for sin in an individual that does not know Christ is unlimited. I just don't get surprised at what people did before they met Christ anymore. I just don't get surprised. And so my father and mother didn't know Christ, and it was kind of a weird situation. I'll go into maybe some of those details another time. But when I was 2 or 3 years old, my parents met Christ. My mother started visiting a church. She invited the pastor and a deacon to come over. She didn't tell my dad to the last minute. My dad cussed her out and then hid all the alcohol because they were Baptist. And then the pastor and the deacon showed up, shared the gospel with my parents in their living room, and my mother and my father met Jesus. They received Christ and started going to church and attended that little church until we moved back to South Carolina when I was 5 years old. And I lived in the upstate of South Carolina. I grew up in Easley and lived there from five until I graduated high school. Now, from 5 years old on, I began to have some issues. Everybody knows that you probably got some issues from your childhood, right? I thought my family was normal till I went to counseling. Then I realized how dysfunctional we are. And every family's dysfunctional. We just got to learn how to put the fun in dysfunctional. That's the successful family right there. There are no perfect families. I'm already feeling sorry for my little girl. Can you imagine her daddy issues when she grows up? So, from the time I was 5 to the time I was 11 or 12, I had a few things happen to me that I tried to put off and not deal with. For example, I was molested twice when I was a little boy. And I tried my darndest to not deal with that. I didn't even tell anybody, listen, till I was in college. Because I felt dirty. I didn't want people to know about that. That was gross. When I was in the 5th grade, my mother and my father separated and nearly got a divorce because it was discovered that my dad was having an affair on my mom. Well, believe it or not, I developed some authority issues. I developed some anger issues. I developed some trust issues. I developed a lot of daddy issues. And I turned to food for my comfort. That's what I used for comfort. Listen, when you don't know Christ, you'll turn to something for comfort. And I turned to food. My father and my mother got back together. It was a miracle that they got back together, but seriously, less than a year after they got back together, it was discovered that my mother had contracted cancer and she passed away. Now, you want to talk about issues? I'm already mad at my dad. I love my mom, and now God takes my mom. I'm a little bitter at God at this point. Everybody in here has probably at one time looked up at the sky and said, "What in the world are you doing?" By the way, he can handle that. I've heard people going, "You don't question God." He is not bothered by your questions. He just isn't. He's never went, "Oh, dang. I owe you an apology." Never has. Never has. Now, I'm not being insensitive. I'm telling you that after I'm telling you he took my mom. So after mom died, it got weird in the house because my dad, as I look back now, I honestly believe my dad was dealing with depression and he did not know how to grieve and the church did not rally around him. I don't blame the church completely. Here's what I know. My dad became very emotionally and verbally abusive to me. When I got home from school, I didn't know if I was going to get yelled at or get hugged. And most of the days it was get yelled at. My dad became very emotionally unstable. He married and divorced twice over the next 7 years. It was a crazy, crazy home to grow up in. I went from being addicted to food to being addicted to food and porn. Because, by the way, nothing in this world can permanently satisfy you, so you always think you need something else when you don't have Jesus in your life. And so I went from food to food and porn because we had a satellite dish and, you know, I could look at all the channels and all that stuff. And so I was very addicted to that. And listen, I went for years on this side of the cross accumulating a lot of baggage. And what was crazy is, in high school, a guy started inviting me to church. I finally started going to church. I met Jesus, and all of a sudden, I'm on this side of the cross because of God's grace to me. But I had baggage, but I tried to deny that there was anything in my past or anything that was dealing with me. I just said, you know what? Straight ahead for the glory of God. I became very self-righteous. I became very legalistic. I became very works-based. And listen, the people that know me, one of the words that people who know me would never use to describe me is lazy. I developed a work ethic that was unreal. And here's what my counselor told me. He said, "You developed a strong work ethic because you feared going back to what you came out of." And so, I worked my way through college. Nobody handed me that. I worked my way through it. I had people tell me I couldn't finish in 4 years. I finished in 4 years. My senior year, I held down 3 jobs. I was going to do whatever it takes to never go back here again. I met Lucretia. I married her in the year 2000. We started NewSpring Church. Now, Lucretia, my wife, was she had finished medical school. She was going into residency. So, 3 years of residency, all they do is work. So, because I just started the church, all I did was work too. I would spend 50, 60, 70, sometimes 80 hours a week working in this church. And people tell me all the time, "Well, this is a miracle of God." You don't have to tell me. I was with 12 people in a living room. I know it's a miracle of God. Like, duh, thank you, Captain Obvious. We started with 12 people in a living room. Before you know it, first service, we had 115. Within 6 months, we go to 2 services. Within a year, we go to we went from the Sullivan Building to the Fine Arts Center. In 2002, we went from 500 people to 1,600 people in 6 weeks. 6 weeks. The next year, we broke the 2,000 barrier and the 3,000 barrier. We were adding services. We were adding staff. We were working hard. We were getting it done, and this was my attitude. You ain't going to outwork me. I stood before the church and said, "I'll preach 5 services. I'll preach 6 services. Keep bringing people. I'll preach." In 2005, though, God tried to... Have you ever looked back and went, "Oh, that was God trying to get my attention"? I was just stupid. Hey, like, I can't say that you were stupid, but I can call me stupid, right? I was like, I was stupid. I almost died in 2005. A few of you were around when that happened. And for those of you that weren't around, I'm not saying I almost stepped in front of a car. I'm talking about some minor surgery, had some major complications, and I spent several days in ICU. I almost died. I had some really close relationships on staff. I had 3 people that were really close to me turn their back on me, and they said some stuff about me that, I mean, those relationships, listen, when somebody close to you turns their back on you, that crap hurts, doesn't it? In 2006, we built this particular facility here in Anderson, South Carolina. We moved in here, and you know what? We were growing. We were moving. In 7 months, we went from 4,000 people to 8,000 people in 7 months. We were adding staff. We were working. In 2007, Lucretia and I had Karis. Well, mainly Lucretia had her. I was a spectator. Woohoo! Push her out. Shove her out. Way out. Like I was that person, right? Everybody's got to be a cheerleader. I was encouraging her. And this was my attitude. That baby ain't going to change my life. I'm not going to slow down. So you know what we did right after Karis in the church? This is how brilliant we are sometimes. We did a capital campaign called Game Time where we raised over $14 million and I was working 60, 70, 80 hours a week with a newborn at home, getting no sleep. In the fall of 2007, a wave of criticism was unleashed against me and our church unlike anything I'd ever seen. And I remember going to Outback with Lucretia in December of 2007, sitting at a table, and I remember looking at my wife, and listen, this is where it's going to get as raw as it's ever gotten in this church. I told my wife, we have a great house. We have some nice cars. We're living comfortably. The church is growing at a rate I never thought it would grow. I'm getting asked to speak at conferences nationwide, and I hate my life. From December of 2007, for the next 3 years, I want you to listen to me. There were days that I considered ending it all. And I'm on this side of the cross. I considered taking my own life. And you know why I didn't? I finally came to the conclusion that that is the most selfish, cowardly act that a human being can commit. The wake of destruction that leaves behind is not worth it, but I'm telling you, there were days where I just wanted out of here. And the reason I'm saying that is because I'm absolutely convinced in a room this size and in Columbia and online and listening to our podcast, I'll guarantee there are people in this room the past week, the past month, even the past year, you've thought about it. In fact, listen to me, there are people here that you're like, I've thought about it because God's given up on me. And I would say, he brought you here to hear this, didn't he? If he had given up on you, you wouldn't be here. I chose to come here. He brought you here to hear. You don't have to go through what you're going through. Yes. You got to get that. So let me walk through it. Let me tell you what got me there, and let me tell you what brought me out of it. What got me there, number one, many of you can fill in these blanks, an unrealistic pace. An unrealistic pace. I set a pace in my life that was absolutely unsustainable. I love speed. I love speed. Love speed. I borrowed a friend of mine's sports car one time. It was a Mustang Shelby GT. It had like 500 horsepower. In the NewSpring Anderson parking lot, I got it to 70 in first gear. What about your daughter? She was in the back seat having a ball. Told you she's going to have issues when she grows up. But you know what? That little odometer thing, it... And that RPM thing, it gets into the red. You know what? You can't keep it in the red for a long time before the engine completely breaks down. And for the people in this room that are going Mach 2 with your hair on fire, eventually you hit a wall. Hey, you know what I discovered? We live in a beautiful world. But sometimes we can't see the beauty because we're going so fast. I was in Jackson Hole 2 weeks ago on a snowmobile, speed, 60 to 70 miles an hour those things will go. And I am wearing this snowmobile, I'm just wearing it out. And something happened, I had to slow down. And when I slowed down, I looked around me and I saw mountains, I saw trees covered in snow, I saw some of the most beautiful scenery you've ever seen in your life. And I remembered something my counselor told me, only when we slow down and see the beauty can we experience intimacy. The reason there's not a lot of intimacy in marriages today is because they don't slow down to discover the beauty. The reason a lot of people have no intimacy in their relationship with God is because they don't slow down long enough to see the beauty. And for the person that's going, well, I'm not sure, Perry, maybe I see the beauty, maybe I don't, I would just simply ask you, when's the last time you slowed down enough just to take in a sunset? See, we're always in a hurry. Let's go, let's go, let's go, let's hurry, let's hurry, let's hurry. The other night I was getting Karis out of the shower. I was like, baby, we got to go, we got to hurry, we got to hurry. She was like, why, Daddy, where do we have to be? So I got confronted on this. I have some godly men in my life. I have some godly mentors. I have a godly counselor. I had a mentor call me out. He said, you're going too fast. You're going too hard. And I got mad at him because depressed people get mad at people just like that. And I was like, people are going to hell, man. And the devil never takes a day off. He simply asked me, Perry, I'm not sure he should be your example. Why we got to talk about me? You jacked up too. Anyway, so that's what we do. No, seriously. In Exodus chapter 20, if you read through the Ten Commandments, do you know the longest commandment that God gave the Israelites was the one on rest? He took more time explaining the commandment to rest than any other commandment in the scriptures. Do you know on the last week of the life of Jesus Christ when he was here on earth, as you read through the gospel, you can't find where he did anything on the Sabbath and he was Jesus. In the last week of, the last week of his life, did he have a pretty big honking to-do list? But he took a day of rest. What do you do for rest? What do you do for fun? Do you have a release? My counselor asked me that. He said, what do you do for fun? I said, I work out. He said, if it's fun, you ain't doing it right. Right? I realized I couldn't answer him. I could not answer him and tell him when the last time I was that I had fun. I had an unrealistic pace that did not allow me to see the beauty that God had placed in my life. Number two, an unrealistic expectation of others. Depressed people are usually mad at other people. And listen to me, if you're here and you're depressed, I'm not picking on you. I spent 3 years mad at other people. Because listen, when you get in that frame of mind, everything that is wrong in your life is everybody else's fault. I did more damage to my marriage in that 3 years than you could imagine. Because I blamed Lucretia for everything. If you just give me more affirmation, if you just give me more affection, if you just encourage me more, if you just do this, if you just do that, how would you like to be that wife that heard that all the time? Hey man, when you take marriage vows, you say for better, for worse. For 3 years, I showed her what for worse was. And I apologized to her, and I repented of my sin to her, and I told her, thank you for sticking by me, because let me tell you about something about my wife. She stuck by me. She encouraged me. She supported me. She never walked out on me, and I promised her I'll spend the rest of my life showing you the for better part of our vows. If you're going through depression, it's kind of, who was it, John Mayer that said, waiting on the world to change? Yeah, that ain't going to happen. If that's your theme song, you need to get another song. It's not going to happen. You got to quit blaming other people. Listen, to blame is lame. Tweet that. You really do. This is your attitude. If people at my work, if people in my family, if my wife, if my boyfriend, if my girlfriend, if my children, if all of them would change, my life would get better. And you begin to develop unrealistic expectations of others. Third is an unrealistic view on life. An unrealistic view on life. I was angry. I was just mad. I could not sleep, but I was exhausted, which led to more anger. You ever been there? You can't sleep, and then you're mad at yourself because you can't sleep. You're like, how freaking hard is it to go sleep? And then I look over and Lucretia's sleeping like an angel. I never did that. Never did that. Thought about it. She's a second degree black belt. Remember that. But seriously, I couldn't sleep. Lucretia told me during that time I was an emotional roller coaster. She never knew. She said, I never knew if I was going to wake up with Dr. Jekyll or Mr. Hyde. And this is what I kept saying to people. Anytime somebody would talk to me about it, I'd say, it's just a phase of life I'm going through. Some guys call this a midlife crisis. You know what a midlife crisis is? A man who takes his eyes off Jesus. That's what a midlife crisis is. A man who takes his eyes off Jesus. I told everybody it was a phase. I was like, somebody would talk to me and say, hey man, you got problems. And listen, on the flip side, on the flip side, I expected everybody else around me to change. I kept saying, this is a phase of life I'm going through. One of these days, it'll just all get better. I expected to continue down that path, and one of those days, everything will change. But many of us know what the definition of insanity is, doing the same thing over and over and over again and expecting to get different results. If you're there, listen, it's not a phase of life. It's a pit that you're in. And number four, an unrealistic desire to be liked by everyone. An unrealistic desire to be liked by everyone. Now, you might find this hard to believe, but there are people out there that hate my guts. I know that's incredibly difficult for some of you to grasp, but it's true. It really is true. And let me give you a news flash. I hate to be hated. I seem to have the gift of ticking people off. But I hate being hated. Because I thought everybody should like me. And people say, Pastor, don't take that stuff personally. Let me share with you an illustration that you'll never forget. Telling me not to take it personally would be like me standing in the lobby tonight and you walking up and kicking me in the nuts. And then saying, don't take that personally. Bro, you just kicked me in, like, that hurt. You got that, right? You got that? You'll never forget that, will you? Because at the end of the day, let me tell you something. I have not done everything right. I've said some things and done some things that I regret. I am not a perfect person. But let me tell you who Perry Noble is. Let me tell you who Perry Noble is. At the end of the day, I'm a guy that was on my way to hell. That God, by his grace, saved me. He changed me. He made me into a brand new person. And his mercies are poured out on me and made brand new for me every single morning. And I want that experience for everybody on this planet. That's all I want. I am not an angel. But at the end of the day, listen, I literally tried to reach out to some of the people that attacked me online. You got to be very careful, by the way, if somebody will take a 1 to 2 minute sermon clip and copy and paste it and say, this is who he is. It's very dangerous to judge somebody from 1 to 2 minute sermon clip. It's very dangerous to judge their 20-year ministry on 2 minutes. How would you love to be judged on the worst 2 minutes of your life? I mean, come on now. I tried to reach out to some of these people. You know what? You know what I discovered? And I discovered the hard way. They didn't want to talk to me. They wanted to talk about me. And that stuff, it carries a weight. So what do you do? What do you do when you're there? Because let me help you. If you're depressed, it's a combination of two things. It's not just one thing, it's a combination of two things. It's a combination of, number one, what has happened to you. And let me help you. What has happened to you in life is legit. What has happened to you? Listen, it's got baggage. You were abused. You were emotionally abused. You were physically abused. You were raped. You were hurt. You were wounded. And the message tonight is not get over it. Because it's not that easy. You just don't Get over that, because that hurts, and it hurts on a soul level, does it not? So it's what's happened to you, but it's also a result of the choices that we make. It's not either or, it's both and. It's a result of what's happened to us, and it's a result of the choices that we've made. Because let's be honest, every one of us in here have made some bad choices that have led to the state that we're in. It's a combination of both, but let me help you. If you want to get out of depression, it's going to have to do with the choices you make. Period. You're going to have to stop being a victim and identifying yourself as depressed. I'm depressed. As long as you say it, you will be. You want to get out of it? You've got to freaking punch it in the throat. And you've got to take ownership over it. How do you do that? Three ways. Daniel did it. This is what I did. Number one, denial does not help. It only hurts. Denial does not help. It only hurts. You cannot deny what you're going through and it get better. I was driving to Atlanta one time on my way to the airport. I was spending some time in Atlanta traffic. In fact, I got to spend some time in Atlanta traffic last night. And it was awesome. About 85% sure I didn't cuss. I'm 100% sure I wanted to. And don't judge me. You did too, all right? But we were driving Atlanta traffic late to the airport. I'm in my little Suzu Rodeo, and I heard pop! Now, everybody help me. What was that? Flat tire. See, everybody knew that. And I knew that. But I pretended it didn't happen. I just kept driving. 75 miles an hour, baby. Fighting it. I was like, something's not right here. I kept going. My buddy, who was in the seat with me, said, yo, dog, really? Like, really, we're going to keep doing this right here? I went, what? Everything's fine. I'm good. What your problem is? He said, I think the tire's flat. I said, roll down the window and see. He rolled down the window, stuck his head out. Rubber's flying all up, hit him in the face. Looked back, got two black eyes. He said, yeah, man. I think the tire, he said, dude, there's no rubber on it. It's shredded. Sparks are flying. I'm like, I think we're good. I think we're going to make it. I tried to deny the problem, and you know what I did? I put my life in danger, and I put his life in danger. Listen, if you deny the state that you're in, and I've had people say, well, it's my life, it's only affecting me. Oh, you're so foolish. You're so foolish. It's affecting your family. It's affecting your friends. It's affecting everybody around you. I love the fact that Daniel didn't try to deny the problem. He didn't say, well, the king ain't gonna kill me. I wasn't even there. No. I want you to look at what Daniel did. Daniel did this. Daniel in Daniel chapter 2, verse 17, the Bible says, verse 14. The Bible says, when Arioch, the commander of the king's guard, had gone out to put to death the wise men of Babylon, Daniel spoke to him with wisdom and tact. He asked the king's official, or the king's officer, why did the king issue such a harsh decree? Arioch then explained the matter to Daniel. At this, Daniel went into the king and asked him for time so that he might interpret the dream for him. Daniel said, I ain't going out like this. And the Bible said that Daniel rolled up on the king and said, give me some time and we'll get this taken care of. Daniel did not try to deny the problem. He punched it in the flipping throat. You and I, if we want to get out of the state of depression, if we want to get out of the state of feeling overwhelmed, you can't run from it anymore. You've got to address it, and address it means admitting that you have a problem. You know what keeps people from doing that? Because you know what kept me from doing it for 3 years? Good old-fashioned pride. Let me tell you something about pride. Pride leads to prison. And you know what you find in prison? Emotional death, spiritual death, relational death, and for some of us, physical death. You cannot get better by denying the problem. You got to deal with it. Number two, I can't do life alone. Sounds like one of our core values. I can't do life alone. You know what's amazing to me about this particular text? Daniel's one of the strongest men in the entire Bible. He's considered to be one of the major prophets. I mean, Daniel pulled out that whole thing in the lion's den that we're going to talk about in several weeks. That's a pretty incredible deal. But Daniel, when he finds this out and he tells the king, I'm not going to deny this, I'm going to deal with it. The Bible says this in verse 17, then Daniel returned to his house and explained the matter to his friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego is how most of us know them. Look at this. He urged them to plead for mercy from the God of heaven concerning this mystery so that he and his friends might not be executed with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. During the night, the mystery was revealed to Daniel in a vision. Then Daniel praised the God of heaven. One of the strongest men in the scripture could not do life alone. And he goes to his friends and he says, guys, I'm in an overwhelming situation. My life is at stake. Guess what, guys? Your life is at stake. And his friends did not judge him. And his friends did not criticize him. And his friends did not throw rocks at him. They got on their knees with him. They got on their knees for him. And together, through the power of God, they overcame this problem. You understand that you and I need each other. We've got to have community in our lives. I especially want to push down on the men for a second, because I know men that go, I got Christian community. No, you don't. You have some people from your church that you talk about football with. Who's the guy in your life that you can talk about the deepest issue in your soul with, men? Well, men don't do that. Maybe that's why there's a lack of men in the church. You and I can't do life alone. Daniel couldn't do life alone. Hey, Jesus, when he's going to the Garden of Gethsemane, did he go there alone, or did he get Peter, James, and John and say, go with me and pray because my soul is grieved to the point of death? Even the Son of God modeled for us, we can't do life alone. That's why we have church. We have church because God didn't intend for us to do life alone. And I'm telling you, NewSpring Church is a place where it's okay to not be okay. If the pastor is on stage right now telling you how jacked up he was, it's okay for you not to be okay. It's not okay to stay not okay, but you cannot be okay here, and nobody will judge you, and nobody will throw rocks at you, and nobody will condemn you. We're called to come beside you, to help you, support you, lift your hands up, and help you by the grace of God get through your problem. I praise God for a godly wife. I praise God for godly friends who stood with me. And when this came out that I was dealing with depression, when this came out that I was struggling with issues and that I was going to need some counseling and I was going to need a break and I was going to need some time to deal with this, my friends and the staff in this church did not criticize me and they did not condemn me. They rallied around me. And they supported me, and because of my friends, through the power of God, I was able to come out of this. I'm telling you, we can't do life alone. Hey, here's the thing that really stinks. I hid it from people for years. Hey, I preached on this stage for 3 years, and none of you knew it. You can fake it for a long time, but eventually you hit the wall. You've got to have the help of others. Number three, the solution began with addressing what was broken inside of me. The solution began with addressing what was broken inside of me. Here's what was crazy. It didn't get better till I stopped blaming everybody else for my problems. Have you ever been in a situation and you just want relief? I mean, you'll do anything just to get relief. And I'm begging God for relief, and you know what? God didn't want relief. He wanted me to repent. Big difference. I was asking God to pull me out of the situation, and God was going, I'm going to lead you through it. We've got a desire for God not to pull us out, but to lead us through. We've got to desire repentance more than relief. And you know what? You know when things changed for me? This is when things changed for me. When I stopped praying, God changed my wife, and God changed my family, and God changed my church. God changed my friends. God brought me to the point of brokenness. He humbled me. He took me to my knees, and it got better when I began praying, God, change me. Change my heart. Something's wrong with me. I'm jacked up, God. Change me. Do a work in me. And you know what? He did. See, a lot of depressed people don't want to hear that. A lot of depressed people want, well, you just need some more, you just need more hugs. You don't need hugs. You need to humble yourself before God and say, what is it that's broken in me? Because you know what God revealed to me? I had pride issues. I had anger issues. I had fear of man issues. That's why I was so obsessed with critics. I had a mentor tell me the quickest way to forget what God thinks about you is to focus on what man thinks about you. I had selfishness issues. I had so many issues I had to repent of. Listen, it was just baggage that had to be dealt with. And you know what? I'm on the other side of it now. Hey, listen, when you leave tonight, don't feel sorry for me. I'm good. I'm not preaching hurt. I'm preaching out of hope. Because I know God brought me through. Listen, you know what God did for Daniel? God gave Daniel a greater view of himself, which is one of the greatest things he can do for any of us in this room. Because after this situation, Daniel says this about God in verse 20. He says, praise be to the name of God forever and ever. Wisdom and power are his. He changes times and seasons and sets up kings and deposes them. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to the discerning. He reveals deep and hidden things. He knows what lies in darkness, and light dwells with him. I thank you and praise you, O God of my fathers. You have given me wisdom and power. You have made known to me what we ask of you. You have made known to us the dream of the. You have made known to us the dream of the king. Let me tell you something. Right now, today, my walk with God is closer than it's ever been. I know I've seen more of Jesus since I came out of this than I've ever seen. God didn't want to bring me out of it. He wanted to bring me through it. And listen, because he was trying to save me from me. Not only did Jesus save me from hell, but he saved me from me. That's a pretty incredible miracle right there. And here's what's so beautiful about this, because if you're in this and you're struggling, and you're like, man, there's no way out of this. If God can bring Daniel out of what he went through, if God can bring me out of the 3 years of hell I lived through, God can bring you out of what you're going through. I don't care if you've been in it for 3 years or for 30 years. You can come out. Listen, you can live in so much freedom, it's not even funny. I've had people ask me, did you go on medication to come out? Nope. Now, I want to call a timeout real quick and say, if you're on depression medication, I don't think that's bad. Some people need that. I believe in common grace. But I talked with my doctor and I talked with my wife, and we decided, you know what? I'm coming out of this. I'm coming out of this. I'm not going to live that way anymore. The risen Lord Jesus Christ lives in me, and I am not a victim. I can walk in victory, not because of who I am, but because of who Jesus is. And this is what he did for Daniel. After Daniel went in front of Nebuchadnezzar and he interpreted the dream, and he told Nebuchadnezzar the dream and what it meant, Nebuchadnezzar lost his mind again, but he lost it in the right way. And the Bible says in chapter 2, verse 46, then King Nebuchadnezzar fell prostrate before Daniel and paid him honor and ordered that an offering and incense be presented to him. The king said to Daniel, surely your God is the God of gods and the Lord of kings and a revealer of mysteries, for you were able to reveal this mystery. Then the king placed Daniel in a high position and lavished many gifts on him. He made him ruler over the entire province of Babylon and placed him in charge of all its wise men. Moreover, at Daniel's request, the king appointed Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego administrators over the province of Babylon, while Daniel himself remained in the royal court. God prospered Daniel after the most overwhelming circumstance he had ever gone through. I want you to listen to me. If you feel overwhelmed, God's not trying to punish you. He's trying to prosper you. He don't want to bring you out of it. He wants to lead you through it. And the God that led Daniel and the God that led your pastor will lead you, because he's that faithful. And listen, only God can use our pain for our progress. Only God. So if you're here and that's what you're struggling with and wrestling with, here's the good news. In Christ, you can have the victory. You don't have to live that way anymore. Can we pray? Here in Columbia and online, if you're with us, if you don't mind just bowing right where you are. And Jesus, I pray that through the power of your Holy Spirit over these next several moments, that you would do an amazing work in the lives of people in this church, your church. With heads bowed and eyes closed, you might be here and you're overwhelmed. Listen, you've considered taking your life. You don't have to do that. You're overwhelmed with life. You are depressed, or you feel like you might be. You don't have to live that way anymore. You don't know Christ. You can know him tonight, because he brought you here to hear this fact. He died for your sins, and he's waiting on you to receive him. And here's what we want to do as a church tonight. We want to pray with you, and we want to pray for you. But you've got to be the person to say, you know what? I'm not going to deny this anymore. I'm going to hit it head on. I'm not going to try to handle this by myself, and I'm going to begin to ask God to change me. You know how that begins for many of us tonight? If you feel like that's you, if you feel like this message is for you, if you feel like God has moved your heart and you want someone to pray with you or for you about any of those circumstances that I mentioned, I just want you to stand up right now and walk out the back door, because we've got people back there in the lobby that would love to pray with you and for you. And you just do it. Don't look around. Don't look around. Don't take a survey. Here in Columbia, if you need to go pray with somebody, if something hits you head on, you just do it. Because tonight's the night you don't run from it anymore. Tonight's the night you deal with what happened to you in your past that overwhelms you. Tonight's the night, listen to me, for some of you, you're going to talk about that thing you've never told anybody about. Heads bowed and eyes closed. I just really, really feel impressed to say this. I've not done this all day, but right now there's a young lady. There's a young lady, I don't know if you're at the Anderson campus or the Columbia campus. You're dealing with a sexual abuse issue in your life. You've never told anyone. You feel dirty. You feel ashamed. You feel used. And I really feel with all my heart that God wants you to know that he loves you. And you don't have to live with that guilt anymore. And if that's you, you just need to go and pray with someone right now. Because we got somebody that would love to pray with you, pray for you, not judge you, not condemn you. I don't know who you are. I just felt incredibly led to say that. I have not done that all day long. Here in Anderson, people have responded. If you need to go in Columbia, you go right now. Listen, if you are scared to death and you want somebody to go with you, just ask somebody, hey, would you go with me? Yeah, and that's good. You don't have to do life alone. If anybody else needs to respond, I'm going to keep it up for just a few more seconds. You just go ahead. You do not need to feel embarrassed. If the pastor can stand on this stage and tell you he was messed up, you don't have to feel afraid about being a little messed up. It's all right. It's okay to not be okay. Praise God. Anybody else? Let's go. You cannot deny it anymore. Anybody else? Amen. Praise God. I'm just going to say this. This is going to be the last thing I'm going to say. It's not going to get better if you just sit there. I don't know who that was for. But if you sit there and say, it's not happening, it's not happening, it's not happening, it's not happening, it's just not going to get any better. If you're a Christian, I'm just going to ask you to pray right now, because people are still responding. I'm just going to ask you to beg Jesus to heal people tonight. That chains would be broken. That addictions would be shattered. That hope would be restored. Hey, it takes a lot of courage to stand up and walk out those doors. Listen, don't be me. Don't be me. Don't deny it for years and years and years and hit the wall. If you feel like you're even on this trajectory, you just go right now. If you're in Anderson, you're in the balcony, you just go right now. Hey, it just takes about a minute longer to get down those steps. Anybody else? Amen. Listen, as long as people are moving, we're going to keep the invitation open. You just pray. Christians are praying, and obviously God is moving hearts right now. If you're in Columbia, listen, God is keeping this invitation open for you. There are people that love to pray for you, not throw rocks at you, pray for you, encourage you. You cannot surprise anybody back in that care room. You just need to feel the freedom. It's okay to not be okay. Man, you just need to feel the freedom tonight. God is setting some people free right now. Amen. It's good. It's good. It's good. It's good. It's good. Thank you, Jesus. If you need Christ tonight, you just go. You just go. Overwhelmed. It's not about making an appearance tonight. Perception is not the perfection. Repentance is. Anyone else? God. I'm going to pray, but if anybody else needs to go, as I pray, you just feel the freedom to get up and walk out. Jesus Christ, I thank you that the tomb is empty and that you modeled for your church what it means to go from a crucifixion to a resurrection. That in you we see what victory is. Father, I pray for every person that has responded to the invitation tonight, God, that you would give people hope. God, I believe you saved lives tonight. I believe suicides have been thwarted tonight. I believe the work that the enemy intended for harm, you brought people here, and God, you're going to take it, and you're going to take pain and turn it into progress, because that's just what you do. Father, I pray that you would restore hope tonight, and that chains would be broken. And Father, I pray specifically in this room and in Columbia and for watching online for the people that did not respond, but they know they need to. But God, they just need some time to process this message. Father, I pray they would know that there's a church that they can come to, that they can call, that they can ask for help. And God, that we're going to be here because that's what you've called us to do. Jesus, in you we have victory. May we never forget we're not victims, we're victorious. In your name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Has it been good to be in the house of God today, New Spring Church? Huh? Hey, listen, before you leave, I need you to know two things. Number one, don't feel bad about me. I'm good. I am so good. I'm going to go home tonight and eat some cookies. I am awesome. God brought me out of it. And so I'm doing really good. Next week is going to be amazing. We're going to talk about how not to worry about the economy, and we're going to have all the kids on stage singing. And right in the middle, we're going to throw them all out in the crowd. You get to catch them. It's going to be a stage diving. We're going to teach them how to stage dive next week. I made that last part up, but kids are going to be singing. Listen, church, I love you. I love my church. Let's go outside these doors, live in the victory that Jesus called us to. Have a great week.